Today, I'm joined by the VP of Publishing and General Manager of FTX Games, Casey Dickinson. Hi, Casey.
Hi, Rick. Thanks for having me.
You bet. So, Casey, can you tell our audience a little bit about FTX Games?
FTX Games was founded in 2006. About 6 years ago, we pivoted into the space that we're in now, which is IP-based games for mobile and social. We've worked with some of the biggest names in Hollywood, The Hunger Games, Mission Impossible. We did a deal with Vivid Games for Rocky and Creed and with MGM. And our most recent game is Narcos Cartel Wars, based on the Netflix show. We're very focused on IP-based games and the mobile and social space, and it's been fantastic so far.
Yeah, I mean, IP-based games seems to be a really strong growing trend that's happening throughout the world. And a lot of your traditional players are really looking at that as a new form of building branded content and branded games. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the advantages of having a game that's built around strong IP?
Sure. So we always approach it as a fans first kind of thing. So we try to find fans of great IP, and then we try to really find what's unique and special about that particular property, and then leverage it through making a great game around it. So we view it as a win-win scenario. So we're introducing fans of an IP to a genre of game maybe that they haven't seen before, and we're introducing the IP to fans of a genre that maybe not so familiar with the IP.
And have you found that that's been helpful in developing traction for the game and helping with competitiveness in different, you know, marketing initiatives and so forth? Or what really helps drive the business results that you're looking for when we're talking about branded IP?
Sure. So what we see when we start really bringing IP into existing games or really making games that are from the ground up for that IP, we see all the core metrics have a dramatic impact. We see CPI drop down significantly, which is to be expected. Somebody's going to click on something that they know that has a likeness of an actor that they know from a show that they're a fan of. But we're also seeing it from engagement rates. We're seeing people play longer, play more often, and we're seeing it in conversion, which obviously has a very direct effect on revenue.
So you absolutely see a positive impact from certainly a CPI, but more on the return on ad spend and on the LTV of the different players that are coming into the game.
Right. So we view, I think traditionally you would look at it and you would view licensing as a marketing play. Knowing that the amount of money and royalties that you're going to spend to secure a particular license is going to get offset by having a lower CPI and those kinds of things. And organic traffic obviously increases as well because people are searching for things that they love. But what we're really seeing also, and combined with that, is really, you know, having everything kind of, it lifts the whole package. And we always view it as a rising tide rises all ships. So when an IP is doing well and a new film comes out or the next season of a show comes out, it lifts our brand, and we're there to kind of carry that audience between those iterations and those series.
So talk a little bit about that. What you're telling me, from what I understand, is that, you know, your latest game, Narcos, that when the season has been consumed on Netflix, that you still continue to see the benefit of that IP long after the launch of that season.
Right, yeah, and we're usually very careful about not tying directly into the storyline of the IP. We want it to be a plus one. We want it to be another pillar for people to really explore deeper into that world. So in the case of Narcos, no spoilers, but you know, at the end of season two, everybody knew that Pablo was going to die. So Pablo still lives on in our game for sure. We're building towards season three. We're carrying those fans over. It's 4 months after the series premiered on Netflix. Uh-huh. We know that those shows tend to get binge watched, so a lot of people probably consume that content within the first week. And we just had our most successful week in the game. So the game continues to grow. It's been a fantastic platform for us so far.
Interesting. And so how are you so convinced that it's actually the brand of Narcos and Pablo Escobar around it that's driving the success of the game versus, say, you know, what that game would have looked like without that branded IP? Do you ever do A/B testing, for example, in a particular market or against a particular segment where it may not have the IP against it, but the same gameplay versus actually having the brand?
Yeah, so we did that, actually. We did that with, prior to launching Narcos, we soft launched it in Russia, and we used a code name because we didn't want to necessarily expose it. And this is a practice that's kind of gaining a lot of traction, you know, with a bigger, larger investment on a gaming title, to launch it somewhere else, see how it does, and then kind of carry it over. So any of your dirty laundry doesn't get exposed kind of to that larger audience. And we viewed, you know, with Narcos, because it's a Netflix show, it's also kind of like this event, right? So it's almost like a theatrical release, which we've done with some of our other titles, as opposed to a television show where there's weeklies. So we really wanted to hit strong and hit hard that first day. So we launched the game the day before season two. But during the soft launch, it was non-branded. It was called Medellin Cartel Wars. And that had great KPIs, and we felt very strongly about it. And the game was really solid, so we had a great soft launch. And we ran tens of thousands of users through that. But when we launched it in Narcos, and with the brand around it and with the likeness and everything else, we saw the KPIs go through the roof.
Super. So, I mean, a huge value that you're also obtaining is the ability to use to really drive your creative with all of this IP. Can you talk a little bit about how you think about creative for a game like Narcos, or even some of your other games like The Hunger Games and Creed and Rocky?
Yeah, so, you know, we always, it's that when you're getting a license, that one of the things that you're getting is obviously you're getting the likeness of the actors and the characters within it. And that becomes one of the most valuable pieces. So when we launched Narcos, we used you know, Pablo was everywhere. We definitely used Pablo in the vast majority of all of our marketing assets. As we kind of went further down the road, we were introducing new Sicarios from the show and some that we created ourselves, and those became part of it too. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of expanding the world, but for sure, you know, we wouldn't do a deal unless we knew for sure that we were going to get the likeness of the actors and the characters, because that's what, you know, fans want to see.
Right.
You're not going to play a Narcos game and not see Pablo Escobar. Right.
Right. Yeah, there'd be something missing there.
Yeah.
And do you negotiate with the rights holder for some of the data that, for example, with Netflix, how many people are being able to obtain the people that have watched the show or watched the show at a certain level and then be able to target them on an area like Facebook or any other publisher out there? Is that part of your marketing techniques or, you know, when you sit down at the negotiating table to try and obtain some of that?
We don't necessarily get that granular with the data, but we do for sure want to know what territories the show is popular in. So in the case of Narcos, it was obviously very popular in Central and South America. So we knew from the beginning that was going to be a big part of our marketing strategy, that we're going to go grab some of those users and some of those fans. It also helped guide us on what languages that we're going to localize for launch. So we're localized in 8 different languages at launch, and we're kind of looking and expanding. You know, from the case of Narcos also, you know, Narcos, Netflix isn't in China, so they don't know Narcos. So we're not live in China. Right.
As a publisher, the strength of the game and the quality of the game has got to be vitally important when you're negotiating future rights from different IP holders. How do you ensure that FTX's games are of the highest quality?
Yeah, that's something that we've been really focused on, is making sure that IP holders trust us, and they trust us with their babies. I mean, working on The Hunger Games, we work directly with the author. You know, we in order to create new stories within The Hunger Games world, the amount of trust that we needed to build up and really be able to know that we can take care of it. So, of course, there's a lot of oversight initially in a project, and then kind of as we go along, they start to build that trust and that relationship. Now we have a great reputation in Hollywood. People know that they can trust us with their babies, right? And we take care of them because the fans will let us know if we step over the line. It has to be authentic.
How concerning is fatigue for some of these IP rights holders? Are they concerned that the content could burn out and that it could actually hurt their core product?
Yeah, about 5 or 6 years ago, I think that was probably a little bit more of a concern. Now I think they get it. They're starting to get it. And we're seeing more studios create gaming teams within their organization because they view it as another medium for storytelling. Mm-hmm. As long as there's quality there and it's not an advert game, right? That's a dirty word, especially within FTX games. Advert games are terrible. They're marketing vehicles, and they're not focused on creating real value. Yeah. So we had to do some education around that initially to really tell people, you know, fans, licensors, everybody, developers, that this isn't what we do. We make great, you know, supplementary kind of tangential kind of pieces that support the overall brand. Mm. So we're building communities, you know, and once you start understanding that these are communities that we're building, then it becomes a different approach altogether.
And I suppose it's a great way to extend the life of the brand from, say, one season to the next, or one film of The Hunger Games to the next, and really to keep that core audience engaged throughout after seeing it and engaging with it the first time around.
For sure, for sure. Yeah, The Hunger Games is a great example. We launched before the first film, and we carried on all the way through. So we built our own social pages around the game itself. We have a great, fantastic community around the game itself, and that feeds off of it. There's obviously the fandom for The Hunger Games is amazing. It was quite a wild ride to be on board for that. Alongside Lionsgate, but we've built a great audience for that as well, and they get it, and they've gotten it from the beginning, and we're seeing that more people getting that too.
Super. So if you think about it from a marketing perspective, there's certainly an advantage for the original rights holder. Talk to me a little bit about how you think about marketing, particularly on Facebook. What have been some of the things that you've done that have been more successful?
So, you know, Facebook has been a great partner for us from the beginning. So, you know, from a user acquisition perspective, for sure, but also be able to create those communities and integrate the ability to share great games with other players too, with other fans. So we use everything, and it's been fantastic. So all of our, you know, the community building that we do is around, you know, Facebook groups, because we have private Facebook groups where we let our insiders in, which are the super fans, right? Because we always activate those guys early, kind of in the development cycle, so they can come along for the ride. And Facebook gives us a platform to do that. And then user acquisition from soft launch to full launch to retargeting, doing lookalikes, we do all of it. And it's been a fantastic partnership.
Great. And one of the things that FTX has done really well around the brand or the launch of Narcos is to use worldwide targeting and app event optimization. Can you tell me a little bit about your philosophy and your strategy around really being able to find new pockets of users and players that may be more difficult to find, and making sure that the most profitable ones for you?
Sure. So we at launch, we launched at scale, and we were pretty aggressive about interest targeting. And it goes without saying that it made a lot of sense for us to focus on fans of the show that were on Facebook and they were already fans of the show. That was easy for us. We launched in August, late August, early September, and quickly kind of scaled, and we started doing lookalikes. And then December hit, you know, notorious December, where cost of user acquisition starts to climb. So we really took a look at it and said, okay, well, let's open it up to new territories. You know, Narcos is a global brand. Let's find some more, you know, more players, no matter where they are. So we started to do worldwide targeting, and we paired that with app event optimization. And so not only did we want to, you know, go wide, but we also wanted to find high value users. Right. So we tied in app event optimization in order to find that quality, so that we could really focus on it and then really dive deep into the territories that we're seeing some initial success.
Sure. And the quality of data is so important on app event optimization to ensure that you're optimizing to the right metric. Is that something that you have teams looking at in terms of which, you know, trigger that you actually look at optimizing against?
Yeah, we have a couple of cues that we look at from players that we know, you know, not necessarily that they're already paying, but that they're going to start paying, that they're engaged and that they're involved. So we really focus on those events because those happen earlier in the life cycle of the player, right. And we want to be able to optimize very quickly. I mean, that's the real advantage, is to know what's working and know what's working quickly, so you can double down on it very quickly.
Yeah, it's a real best practice, and we see a lot of the industry leaders really diving deep into that, and it's working well, so it's great. And talk to me a little bit about your marketing team. Do you use agencies? Have you built everything in-house? Do you use Facebook marketing partners?
We do a little bit of both. You know, using outside agencies allowed us to scale really quickly. Traditionally, we were you know, Fun Tactics for a while, and then we rebranded as FTX Games when we were acquired back in March. Prior to the acquisition, we really were focused on kind of taking our value and kind of putting back into new games. And now we're kind of like, okay, you know, we have a game that's really performing. We're really starting to spend a lot on user acquisition. We've leveraged a combination of external teams and building an internal user acquisition team as well.
Great. So recently you received an investment from Playtech. Talk to me a little bit about your relationship with your parent company and how that has impacted maybe your business model or helped enhance your business model through the use of different studios that they have access to.
So Playtech acquired Fun Tactics, and we rebranded as FTX Games back in March. Initially, it was a partnership like any other that we've done, where they had a great development team, Playme, in St. Petersburg, Russia. They were looking for IP to bring into that studio. We have IP, and we work great with developers. So we started working out from that structure from the beginning. And then it became more clear that, you know, maybe it made more sense for them to acquire us and take over publishing. And that's largely what we're doing now. So we're publishing the casual game side business for Playtech. And Playme is the internal studio. And we're still using external developers as well. So we're doing a combination of both, but now we have the resources of a very large publicly traded company behind us.
For sure.
And it's changed the dynamic quite a bit. Some of the bets that we're making now are significantly larger. We're able to kind of play with the big boys, and it's been fun.
But it's also transitioned your business model to really go and look for hungry developers that have really strong gameplay, and to be able to marry what you do well, which is bringing IP rights to the game and really creating a branded experience.
Yeah, and I think that's true. And I think that what we're finding is that we have access to IP. We've been in this game space for a long time. I mentioned earlier that, you know, we have a lot of trust built with IP holders in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. What we're finding is more difficult is to find great development teams and great games. Our goal is really to bring those games that maybe got a little bit of an audience and are being able to have some success but aren't able to turn that positive ROI corner to drive user acquisition. So their lifetime value of users is $2 or $3, and they really need to get it up a little bit higher in order to be able to spend money on it and really scale their business. We know that the introductions that we can make and the IP that we can make, as well as our publishing know-how and being able to handle IP, can turn that corner for them. And then obviously the investment of being able to spend very aggressively on user acquisition post-launch, all of those things combine into kind of a perfect storm. So that's where we are now.
Okay, super. So what's next around the corner for FTX Games?
We have a couple of games that we're working on right now, nothing that we can announce yet. We're going to be exploring some additional genres that we haven't touched in before. It's very exciting. So we have some IP in both in the film space and in the television space that we're looking at. So maybe have two or three launches this year, and then next year we're going to have a pretty significant year.
That's great. And do you find that this space is becoming more competitive, that there's more gaming companies coming out and bidding for IP alongside you, or do you feel like that has yet to really pick up?
It's goes and booms and busts, and I think that there was a phase there where we were getting outbid on every project. People were overpaying, frankly, for IP. We view it as a marketing vehicle, and we know that if you're going to spend $1 million to get a license, you better be able to know for sure that you're going to be able to get that back, because it's a marketing, it's an upfront marketing investment on future success for a game. Now we're seeing that we have, because of our reputation and now with the financial backing that we have a pretty strong stake in it. I think there's
getting outbid a little bit less nowadays.
A little bit. We can certainly write a bigger check now. Yeah. It doesn't necessarily mean that it always makes sense to do that, but we certainly have the ability to do that in times where it does make sense.
Right.
A lot of the big players also are doing into the IP space, but they have been for a while. I think there's room. There's always new movies coming out. That's the fantastic thing. There's always new movies. There's always new shows. There's always great new developers around the corner too. So there's enough room for everybody.
Super. All right, Casey, thanks so much for your time today. And best of luck as you roll forward.
Thanks, Rick.
Thanks.